Been wanting to tell you about this for a long time. This is a Raspberry Pi 5, the newest Raspberry Pi from the Raspberry Pi Foundation. I first saw one of these in April of this year when I spoke to Eben Upton. He explained the differences between a Raspberry Pi 5 and a Raspberry Pi 4 and what makes this so much better.
So this is Raspberry Pi 5. It's the next generation of the Raspberry Pi SBC, single board computer product line. It's a pretty familiar looking object. It's another credit card size computer. For fun, you'll notice the Ethernet connector moved back to where it used to be. You know, one of the things that happened with Raspberry Pi 4 was the Ethernet connector moved over there. It's moved back down there. But, you know, notable things, an almost completely new core chipset. So we have a new power supply. We have a new power supply chip. We have a new piece of core silicon from Broadcom. And then for the first time, you'll see we've got a chip on here, which it's another product with two Raspberry Pi logos on, like Raspberry Pi Pico. It has, for the first time, it's a big Raspberry Pi product on which one of the pieces of silicon was developed here at Raspberry Pi. This is a device that we call RP1, and it's the I/O controller. So it's the thing that provides the USB, provides the Ethernet, now provides the camera and display interfaces, the MIPI camera and display interfaces. Historically, those were integrated onto the main SoC. What's happened on this platform is that a lot of those I/O interfaces, which were previously integrated into the core silicon, have now moved off onto RP1. So the GPIOs are provided by RP1, not by the core silicon now. RP1 is connected to the main SoC. It's another Broadcom SoC called 2712. It's connected to the main SoC by a four-lane PCI Express Gen 2 link, so a fairly beefy link. We can tunnel all of that camera and all of that real-time critical display and camera information and the non-real-time critical but still very high bandwidth USB 2, USB 3, and gigabit Ethernet traffic over that. It's a 16 gigabit link, so it's a good it's a good bit of bandwidth there, and you can see on the board all this vast number of parallel wires there. That's the PCI Express bus between the two chips.
CPU?
CPU quad-core Cortex-A76.
RAM?
LPDDR4X. Between 4 and 8, we have. I believe that we are likely to have choices of 4 and 8 gig. Probably not determined at this point. So I think things that are not determined at this point, exactly what the launch RAM variants are going to be, probably 4 and 8. Exactly what the clock speed of the A76 is going to be, probably north of 2 gigahertz. You're looking at a level of performance which is a little over twice that of a Raspberry Pi 4.
Fantastic. I've been really impressed with the Raspberry Pi 5. It's so much faster in my tests than a Raspberry Pi 4. Eben explained some of the differences between these two, but I've also had the chance to test the Raspberry Pi 5 and see how much quicker it is than a Raspberry Pi 4. Please note that this video is not sponsored by Raspberry Pi. They did, however, send me this Raspberry Pi, a keyboard, and some other devices so that I could test the newest Raspberry Pi from the Raspberry Pi Foundation.
One fun thing, if you look at a couple of other products that have had Raspberry Pi logos on the tops of chips, Pico has RP2040 on. You'll see on the top of that chip it says RP2. There's a general consensus that RP2 must stand for RP2040. It doesn't. If you look at 02W, that has the a SIP on their system in package, which integrates a Broadcom application processor die with some DRAM, some Micron DRAM. That says RP3 on top of it. I'm not sure what the consensus is about that somehow that refers to Raspberry Pi 3, because of course it has the same Broadcom silicon and as Raspberry Pi 3. This piece of silicon says RP1 on top of it. No one's ever asked us what RP1. No one's ever gone RP2, RP3. What's RP1?
So explain it to us.
So this is RP1. It's just the order in which the programs were started. This is the oldest Raspberry Pi silicon engineering program. This program has been running since, in one form or another, since the summer of 2015.
Wow.
Right. So this is an 8-year. Yeah, so that I/O controller is an 8-year program. Had some false starts, but it's an 8-year program.
8 years to get to that.
8 years to get to that.
And I'm assuming quite a bit of money.
A fair bit of money, you know, certainly north of $10 million to develop RP1.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it's cool. So yeah, so custom PMIC, new Broadcom silicon, in-house developed I/O controller. Off-the-shelf LPDDR4X memory, off-the-shelf, it's got the same, the 43455 dual-band Wi-Fi and Bluetooth combo, the same one that we use in Raspberry Pi 3 Plus and Raspberry Pi 4. So that's really the only thing that stayed the same across all the recent generations of the platform.
Eben, what's the biggest difference between, say, this and a 4?
Performance. You have a lot more CPU performance, north of two times the CPU performance. Less headline performance metrics have inched up. So this is a dual 4K P60 platform, where the previous platform was a dual 4K P30 platform. GPU performance has edged up, much more than edged up. GPU performance has gone up quite substantially on this platform. USB performance has gone up on this platform. So where the previous design had a pair of USB 3s and a pair of USB 2s, that were connected over a four gigabit link, we have a pair of, and they were hubbed. So effectively, you have 4 gigabits, then you have a USB controller and an integral hub. So your maximum, you have 2 5 gigabit USB ports, but the maximum bandwidth you can get is throttled by the 4 gigabit upstream. In this design, you have 2 independent USB controllers connected, so you get 5 gigabits out of each one, and the upstream throttle is at 16 gigabits. Now, it's shared with camera and display and gigabit Ethernet, but in practice, you're much more likely to be able to get your peak USB 3 bandwidth out of the system. So there have been some of these subsidiary performance metrics that have inched up. But by and large, it's all about the CPU.
It's amazing how you've been able to keep prices so low and yet ramp up the performance.
Yeah, we worked really hard to, obviously, you know, historically we've had this $35 price point. We worked really hard, particularly in the context of the shortage
and
situation.
Inflation and everything.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, $35 in 2012 is not $35 today. Obviously, the shortage brought with it a lot of cost increase. We were able to absorb most of that. So, you know, if you look at what I think the sum total of our price increases associated with the shortage environment, we moved zero up to a more sustainable price point. So we moved the $5 and $10 products to $10 and $15. That's a $5 increase, but obviously a fairly large proportional increase. We moved all the Compute Module 4 products up by $5. And then we moved 2 gigabyte Raspberry Pi 4 back to $45. We'd actually just brought it down from $45 to $35 when everything kicked off. So we unwound that. So we discontinued the 1 gig at $35, brought the 2 gig down from $45, and then about a year ago, we moved the 2 gig back up to $45, and then we reintroduced the 1 gig. So people still do have a $35 product in the Pi 4 generation.
Now, to really test the CPUs of these two Raspberry Pis, I'm going to use an application called Hashcat. Hashcat allows you to crack passwords or hashes of passwords, and it hammers the CPU. In other words, it drives the CPU hard, or in most cases in the real world, we'd use GPUs to do password cracking. But this gives us a nice example of testing how good the CPU is of a Raspberry Pi 4 versus a Raspberry Pi 5. And I think you'll be pleasantly surprised at how good the Raspberry Pi 5 is. To install this application, you'd use the command sudo apt install hashcat. So I've done that on both of these devices already. So I can use the command hashcat b to run a baseline on both of them. So what I'm going to do now is press enter at the same time. And I just used a basic command of hashcat-b to get a baseline. So on the Raspberry Pi 5, we've got 77,219 kilohashes per second. On the Raspberry Pi 4, we've got 34,000 kilohashes per second. In other words, 1,000 hashes per second. That's for MD5. For SHA-1, on the Raspberry Pi 5, we've got 57,000. Raspberry Pi 4, we've got 26,000. So as you can see, we're getting at least double the hashes. So if I run that again, and I'll just speed this up so that we can see some other options. At this point, we've already got SHA-2, 256, still trying to calculate it on the Raspberry Pi 4. And I'll stop the Raspberry Pi 5 at this point because we've got 127 million hashes a second for MTLM hashes on the Raspberry Pi 5. Takes a while for the Raspberry Pi 4 to catch up.
1 eternity later.
So as you can see here, for NTLM hashes, we've got 58,000 kilohashes per second, whereas with the Raspberry Pi 5, we've got 127 million hashes a second. Now, another application you can use is Sysbench. You install it by typing sudo apt install sysbench. I'm running it on both the Raspberry Pi 5 and Raspberry Pi 4. In this example, I'm going to use 4 threads with prime number of 20,000. Let's see the difference between the two of them. So I'll press enter on both the Raspberry Pis. As you can see, prime number's limit is 20,000. The threads have been started on both the Raspberry Pis. And there you go. So the Raspberry Pi 5 was slightly quicker, but notice the events per second, 4,000, whereas on the Raspberry Pi 4, it's 2,800. Average here on Raspberry Pi 4 is 1.42. Average on Raspberry Pi 5 is 0.96. I personally prefer the Hashcat example. I think that shows it a lot clearer. The output on a Raspberry Pi 5 is just so much quicker. In my general tests, I found that the Raspberry Pi 5 is a lot more responsive compared to Raspberry Pi 4. It's so much better in my tests.
It's been a very long journey. One of the interesting things about Raspberry Pi is what you see from us is the organization grows over time and the programs take a long time to develop. What you see from us at any given time was developed by a much smaller engineering team than the engineering team now. So, you know, you may wonder what all these engineers have been doing for the last few years. And by and large, the answer is this thing here. And it's just exciting to see the light of day. It's an amazing engineering team. To be able to build, this is a RP1 is a vastly more, I love RP2. I love RP2040. But RP1 is a vastly more complicated piece of silicon than RP2040. And it's just been amazing to watch the team over the years put that product together, define it, implement it, iterate it, stabilize it, and make something which we really think is going to be an important part of future Raspberry Pi platforms.
It sounds like you're going the same route as another fruit company where you're doing more and more of your own silicon. And do you see that's where the future's going?
I definitely think, you're likely to certainly see more from us in the, I think it's important to draw a distinction between IO controller silicon and microcontroller silicon on the one hand, and then core silicon on the other hand. This is another 40 nanometer. This is another 40 nanometer device. The core silicon here, the Broadcom core silicon here, is a 16 nanometer device. There's a huge difference between building these big designs on 16 and building even fairly complicated designs on 40. So I think you'll see more. You might see more in the microcontroller space. You might see future iterations of this design. But I think this partition where we do the Raspberry Pi specific engineering ourselves, but continue to work with merchant partners for what we call fast digits for the core silicon, is a pretty good model for us.
Great to see an update from the Raspberry Pi Foundation. Great to see a new single board computer from them after all of these years. I think a lot of us have been waiting for it. Eben has already explained some of the differences in the architecture and so forth. They look very, very similar, but huge performance increase in the Raspberry Pi 5. I'm hoping to create many more videos talking about the Raspberry Pi 5, showing you how to use it in various applications. Let me know in the comments below the kind of stuff that you want to see. Great to see this new single board computer.